Good morning, I'm Byron Jackson, pastor of Calvary Baptist Church. I am Ray's pastor, but most importantly, I am Ray's friend. And those of you who've been in ministry and pastors, you know exactly what that means. So he's invested so much love and support into me. It's an honor to be here this morning to open up the service with you. So Ray's life, Dr. Ray Nolan Tharp passed from this life into his heavenly life early Wednesday morning, March 10th, 2021. Ray was 84 years old and resided in Van Alstyne, Texas, and he is dearly missed by his family and his friends. Yet, we rejoice that he is reunited with our loved ones already in heaven. Ray was born to Raymond Tharp and Madeline McKnight Tharp on May 21, 1936, and he grew up in Siegelville, Texas. His educational background includes graduating from Siegelville High School, majoring in art at Henderson County Junior College, earning a BA from East Texas State University in Commerce, a BM from Tennessee Temple Seminary, an MBA from Southeastern Oklahoma University, and a PhD from Louisiana Baptist University. Ray served as a medic in the U.S. Army. He later met Suzanne Phillips while attending ETSU, and they married in 1963 and had four children. Ray and Suzanne were married for 57 years. Ray pastored various churches in Northeast Texas and Southern Oklahoma, and he and Suzanne also served as directors of Child Evangelism Fellowship in Tyler, Texas for 12 years. His life work was the development and distribution of Every Man's Bible Correspondence course that has circulated around the world. And in memory of Ray, the course will be offered as a free download from www.ebccnet.com. Ray had a passion for teaching and defending the Word of God, and he was a member of Calvary Baptist Church in Anna, where he faithfully taught adult Sunday school until his recent years. My experience with Ray Tharp has been an absolute joy. My heart grieves. That was one of the things my pastor told me when I got into ministry, when he ordained me. He told me some of the highlights ministry would have, and then he proceeded to tell me some of the things that would absolutely rip your heart out. And one of the things that he told me was, you will love people like you've never loved them before, receive love from people that you couldn't imagine, and then you will have the honor of doing their funerals. And those days are going to be some of the most joyous, but some of the hardest. And that is so true. In my short time there at Calvary Baptist Church, it's absolutely true that Ray has become a friend to me. One time when I was getting on to Ray, so we all know Ray had a wreck on his scooter, and Suzanne had been trying to get him, straightened out. And of course, I think even Suzanne said, can you please talk to him and straighten him out, right? So I was talking to Ray, and he just said, let me stop you there. He said, stubbornness is one of my spiritual gifts. And I said, Ray, I don't think so. And he said, no, look it up. So spent some time trying to find it. Suzanne, I still haven't found that yet. So he's going to have to work that out with the Lord. He's going to have time to do it now. So, no, 2 Timothy 3:16, I call that the gospel of the word, I just think 3:16 just reminds me, it's just you stand on it, and that's who Ray was. He believed that God's word was absolutely God-breathed, every word of it, and he understood the importance of using it, that it was for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training for righteousness, so that all children of God could be thoroughly equipped for every good work that God has for them. And he did that faithfully his entire life in ministry. His Sunday school room, although God will do a new thing in that chair, and Ray's excited about that, I'm sure. But at the same time, that room will never be the same either. And we'll remember every time we walk through, and we know where he would go and rightly divide God's word for his class. And his students in that class are changed too. They'll be faithful to follow a new teacher, but at the same time, I know that it just won't be the same. Their teacher that God connected to their heart is not going to be in that room for a while, and it's going to be hard for them. So I'm going to pray for them as well. And I know you and the family and their friends, you're not going to replace a person like Ray. But we gladly give him up to the Lord for him to experience God's peace and rest. And everything that Ray taught and believed his entire life, he's getting to experience right now. So I'm so grateful for that. And so if you would, I'm going to pray, and then we're going to continue. This service is really a service about rejoicing and remembering, right? And so let's do that. Let me pray. So Father, we love you, we praise you, and we thank you for this day. We are strange creatures because while the rest of the world grieves without hope, Father, we gather to rejoice and remember. Father, I thank you, Lord, even this morning as we were here. We had to interrupt and get everybody to sit down and be quiet because there's such joy filling this room because of who you are and what you've done in our lives. Father, we grieve, but we grieve with hope. And we give thanks in Jesus' name for Ray Tharp. Amen.
Amen.
Well, let's hear from the family.
Well, we know that our dad would not want us to be all solemn and somber on this event, and so I'm glad that we've had a lot of laughing, you know, going on, and just, you know, there is joy, even though we're sad because he's not in our presence anymore. It's just a mixture of sadness and joy. So Julie and I wanted to say a few things. So I'm Melissa, this is Julie, for those of you who don't know. Stephen is another son. Jonathan is up here on the front row, so Ray had four children. And then we've got grandchildren over here behind on the second row, first row and second row. I think that's where they all are. Julie has something she wants to say before I... Well, I'm one who has to write up my thoughts a lot before I say, and I have a talent given to me, not by God, only by God, my mom too, is able... as a good writer, and I write occasionally, and sometimes I feel like the best way to put things and speak my heart is through a poem. So I do have a poem, and this kind of goes back to when I got to speak to my dad the last time, and I told him, I want you to stay, but I knew it was time for you to go. And so I just remember saying that to him, I want you to stay, but you know, it was just, I knew it was time for you to go. So I wrote a poem, and it's titled, Dad, I Want You to Stay. And all of you who know my dad, you know how corny he's been all his life, you know, just silly jokes. And so you'll kind of get some of the stuff that I say based on some of the little phrases he would like to say to us. But I want you to stay to hear your corny jokes. I'm glad you got to see me, to all the kin folks. I want you to stay to hear your soft voice, sweetly singing Advent hymns of rejoice. I want you to stay to see you walk again, for you have always been my champion. But it was time for you to go, and now you walk the streets of gold. Heaven's champion through life and death, you inspired others to know Christ even until your last breath. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? For there is no death in life, but life everlasting. Some shall awake to everlasting life, and some to shame and disfavor. But I thank our Lord Jesus Christ, who is our Savior. For as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. And I would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. Love your daughter, Julie.
Amen.
Amen. So I just wanted to share some of my memories of our dad. And as I didn't want to think it through a whole lot because I really wanted to talk through the heart, but David, you know, asked me about his salvation experience, and I started thinking about that, and I thought that would be something neat to tell because I remember the way he told it to me, if I'm remembering correctly. My memory hasn't been, my thought processes haven't been very good this week, so I'll try to remember it the best I can, but he said that one day he had gotten choked on an orange, and he really thought he was going to die. And then it wasn't long after that he was in school and the Gideons came to speak. And he sat there and listened to the Gideons present the gospel. And it just, the Holy Spirit moved in his heart. And that's when he gave his life to Christ. And then I believe it was after he was he went to junior college after he graduated from high school, and then he always talked about how he got this really nice letter. And what president would that have been?
Eisenhower.
Was it from Eisenhower at Christmas? A Christmas card that was drafting him into the army. And so he was drafted into the army and served as a medic. And then, again, if I remember correctly, it was during that time frame that he really began to feel the call of God on his life. And so, you know, he eventually did, you know, become an ordained minister and go into the ministry, and he pastored various churches. And so growing up, some of the memories that I have, I mean, I remember being in church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, and I loved going to church. We all went to church growing up, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. And there were periods of time where my dad was pastoring, and there were periods of time where he wasn't. My parents were also directors of Child Evangelism Fellowship in Tyler, Texas, and they did that for 12 years. And so that was also during our childhood growing up. And I also remember when he wasn't pastoring, I remember sitting with him in church. I would always put my arm through his, and just, that was just what I did. I just sat by my daddy and I put my arm through his in church and listened to the preaching. And we also, we've talked about this, how we just also thought our dad had such a beautiful singing voice. And as a little girl, I just remember looking up at him as he sang those hymns, you know, just sang out, and he just had such a beautiful voice. And I admired that so much. And then in my teenage years, my memories of him, I have a lot of memories of just sitting with him in the living room, asking him questions about theology. And he would tell me from the scriptures what the Bible says, and he would teach me Bible doctrine and theology. And because of that, that is just, that laid the foundation for my faith. Because I feel that I have a strong faith today because of the things that my dad taught me. And my mother was also a very integral part, too. Of, you know, they taught all of us about God and taught us God's word. And but just having those long conversations with him, and he knew the Bible so well. And I believe that he read the Bible through 50 times, once a year, every year for 50 years.
Over 60 years.
He read the Bible through every year. And when I realized that too, that really convicted me. Wow, that my dad had that kind of dedication. And then also memories that us children have as well, with my parents being directors of Child Evangelism Fellowship, we would go in the summers to a training, and we would be trained on how to conduct five-day clubs in the summer. And then, and our whole family would do this together. And then we would go into people's homes, and they would invite the neighborhood children. We would teach Bible stories and stories about missionaries and sing songs. And we did this as a family. And so just the memories that we have at the, they called it Christian Youth in Action Training, and then spending our summers teaching these five-day clubs too, are just such wonderful memories that we have with my dad. And so my dad was just, he was so dedicated to spreading the gospel. And I have to include my mother in that as well, you know, because they were partners in that. And my dad was so passionate about teaching the Word of God and defending the Word of God. I wanted to share just one more thing, or maybe two. I wanted to share about, you know, this, his passing caught us off guard. He had surgery, and we just were confident he was being covered in prayer and he was going to come through it and be fine and have a better quality of life. And he actually did. He does. He has a better quality of life now. And as we talked about it, we were like, you know, our expectation was earthly. We thought he was even getting treatments on his knees and he was starting to walk again. And he was hopeful that he would be able to get out of that wheelchair. And so that's what we were focused on, that he was going to have a better quality of earthly life, and yet he has, he's more alive ever than he's ever been now. And that is just amazing to think about that. So one of the things that really comforted me during this time is, so the morning that he passed away, David, he was there with us in the hospital, and then he went on back home so that he could tell our two boys about it. And so he texted me later, and he texted me a scripture verse, 2 Corinthians 5:8. And I read that, and I really felt comforted by that. And later in the evening, I thought, oh, the last thing that I had put on Facebook was for people to pray for my dad's surgery. I need to put something else on there letting people know that he passed away. And so I was creating a post, and I thought, I'm going to copy that scripture that David texted me and put it on there. Well, I couldn't get it to copy from his text message. So I went to my Bible app to pull up the scripture from in my Bible app and copy it. And when it came up, I was going to look for 2 Corinthians. It had already said 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And I was just surprised. I was like, what? Wait a minute. And I thought, oh my goodness. Yesterday, my reading was 2 Corinthians 4. This is where my Bible reading lands today, is on this passage. And I could just see that was God. He timed that to send us a message, you know, that he knew in advance that he was preparing to bring my dad into heaven. And he timed it that way, you know, just to show us, hey, you know, I'm in control, and I'm with him through all of this and with you all. So I just want to read that, and it's on the back of your folder here, 2 Corinthians 5, 1 through 8. So this is the passage that was my Bible reading. For we know that if our earthly tent, which is our house, is torn down, we have a building from God, a house not made by hands, eternal in the heavens. For indeed, in this tent we groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling from heaven. Since in fact, after putting it on, we will not be found naked. For indeed, we are in this tent, we who are in this tent groan, being burdened, because we do not want to be unclothed, but to be clothed, so that what is mortal will be swallowed up by life. Now he who prepared us for this very purpose is God, who gave us the Spirit as a pledge. Therefore, being always of good courage and knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith and not by sight. But we are of good courage and prefer rather to be absent from the body and to be at home with the Lord. And then one final thing that I wanted to share, and I thought that this might be touching for those of you here that are family members. A couple days before my dad's surgery, I was in the hospital visiting with him, and he said, I want to tell you about a dream that I had. He said, I dreamed that I was looking into heaven, and he said, and all of our family members who have died were standing there, and they were looking at me. And he named them all off, and they're people that many of you, you know, your parents and, you know, our grandparents, aunts and uncles and cousins who have passed away. And he named them all one by one, that he looked at them and saw them, and they were gathered together. And he said, I felt like I was being given an invitation. And I said, well, Dad, so if you're being given an invitation, did you think that maybe it was something that you could accept or reject? And he said, well, yeah, I kind of thought that. And he said, I thought about it. And it seemed tempting to him, you know. But then he said, you know, but I just really want to get in the pool at my apartment complex this summer. So he said, no, not yet. But that also has given me comfort to know that Aunt Jimmy was standing there, Grandmama and Granddaddy, Mama and Papa, Aunt Raynine was standing there. He mentioned it, Matthew, Uncle Clifford, Uncle Big Ben, yeah, him too. That's right. He named them all. And so when he passed away, I just couldn't get that vision out of my head. I could see them, and I could see that they had formed a welcome party, and they were having a reunion with him. And they were so glad to have him where they are. And so, you know, that's also just brought a lot of comfort. So we just appreciate you guys being here today. And, you know, just thank God that he has given us eternity with him, that he made a way for us to be in eternity with him where we'll never suffer again and never have these sick old bodies again. So we want to invite all of you right now to sing with us. We're going to sing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. And so we'd like to ask you to stand up and let's just worship God.
That saved a wretch like me. So my name's David. I'm Melissa's husband, Ray and Suzanne's son-in-law. When I think about Ray, I think about consistency. You know, Ray was, he was always the same every time that I saw him. Regardless of how good of a time we were having or how bad the time was, I always count on Ray to be the same. I think the most that I ever saw him get excited is whenever there was food and family involved. Some of the things that I remember is I remember this one Thanksgiving that we were watching the Cowboys football game, and I don't know what happened to all the rest of the family, but everybody was gone. It was just Ray and I were sitting there watching the game, and the food was still left out, and man, Julie, he sure did like that peach cobbler you made. I don't know how many bowls he ate, but it was a lot. We had a good time that day. I think that, you know, for all the family, you know, I could see whenever I first met Melissa and I came to one of the first family reunions of Suzanne's family, I saw this big, you know, loving, close-knit family. I could just see it right off. But there was one thing that scared me. It's when I met Jack. Jack, I love you, brother. I just want you to know, I love you. But one of the only times that Ray was, and now I'm not, this is serious now, only one of the few times Ray was really serious with me, he was like, listen, don't pay any attention to Jack. That was some of the best advice he gave me. You know, thing about Ray and Suzanne too, such a heart for evangelism. You know, I mean, like, one of the things that I would see that would always get Ray really fired up and excited was whenever, you know, God would be instrumental in using him to lead someone to the Lord. And he was all about that. Eschatology, end time stuff, man, he's always looking for the rapture. You know, and I thought about that today, is that the good news is, you know, is that he didn't miss the rapture. You know what I mean? He's going to go on ahead of us, but thank God he won't miss that, because he loved talking about the rapture and the return of Christ, and he was so looking forward to that. And so I'm grateful today to know that he is in the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
Yes. You know, I think about how Jesus acted at funerals. And you know, there's a story. There's his closest friends were Mary and Martha and Lazarus. Those were his closest friends on earth, from what we read from scriptures. And you know the story of whenever Lazarus passed away, And Jesus, you know, they came and told Jesus, and he stayed 4 days. He didn't go. He waited 4 days. And he comes and he shows up. And when he shows up, Martha comes running out. And it's almost as if she's accusing him. She says, Lord, if you'd been here, my brother, he wouldn't have died. And Jesus said, oh, your brother, he's going to rise again. This is as if Martha cuts him off right in the middle, knowing her personality. Oh, well, I know he'll rise again with the dead. It's like, I've been to Sabbath school. I know what's going to happen. And Jesus says one of the most important things he ever said. He said, I am the resurrection and the life.
Amen.
So what he's telling her is it's not that Lazarus is going to rise again someday. He's like, resurrection is right here and right now. I'm here. I am resurrection. So resurrection isn't something you only experience in the future. Resurrection, see, if you've been born again, you know this. Resurrection is something you experience right here and right now. Heaven isn't something you experience then and there. I mean, we rejoice in knowing that Ray is in the presence of the Lord. He's there in heaven. But you know, what got Ray so fired up about evangelism was the fact that, as you heard Melissa tell the story, that salvation experience that he experienced. See, he experienced heaven coming to earth in his heart, bringing transformation. So heaven isn't just something then and there. Heaven is something that is here and now as well. And that's what. And see, then Jesus tells Martha, he says, after he says, I'm the resurrection and the life, then he asks her the most important question of all. Said, do you believe this? And she said, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the very Son of God. The best answer ever. So, you know, as we talk about Ray, how good of a man he was, how he served the Lord all those years, he is not in heaven today because he was a good man. He is in heaven today because he lived his life for Christ. He put his faith in Christ. He was in Christ. You see, one of the things we fumble over with the gospel in our Christianity in America today is that we know that a Ephesians 2:8 says, you are saved by grace through faith. Do we know that grace saves us? We always say, yes, you know, it's all an act of God. We believe that grace saves us. And here's our problem. We have this 90-10, all of us. We struggle, myself included. It's like, I believe 90% of that, but I think 10% I've got to be good for God to accept me. There's got to be something I got to do good for God's favor to be on my life. And that's exactly opposite of what the Bible teaches. You're saved by grace. I mean, if you're reading that in the Greek, the Greek syntax, the most important word comes first. The first word there is grace in the Greek. Because that's most important. Not by works. So dear family and friends, listen, today as we come to honor Ray's life, let's take a deep look at salvation. Let's take a deep look in our own hearts, because see, here's what all of us know. This life is temporary.
That's right.
It is coming to an end. Yeah. Everything you see and you know. It doesn't matter how good of a person you are, how bad of a person, how much you serve the church or you don't serve the church. What matters, are you in Christ? Mm-hmm. Have you placed that faith that God has given you in Christ? That is the most important thing. And I think, you know, how we honor his life is by looking into our own.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. A life well lived should inspire all of us. Mm-hmm. All of us give too much to this world and not enough to the Lord.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Now I've gotten way too serious because I know I heard all those corny jokes that Ray told. The first time I was around the family who told those corny jokes and everybody started laughing, I didn't know what was going on.
It's okay, Bridget.
The consistency of Ray, though, is that he was a kind man.
Amen.
You know, I think that one of the most impressive things to me about Ray is that Melissa told me, she said, never one time did he say anything mean to me. Very few people can say that about their parent. That is truly a testimony of what kind of a man he was. That is consistency. That is something to admire. So I'm going to say a prayer now, and then the military is going to come and do their thing. We'll come back and we'll pray again. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. So Father, we thank you for salvation. We thank you for that grace.
Thank you, Lord.
That Ray dedicated his life to you, Lord. We thank you that today, God, as we come together, that we have hope. And the only reason we have hope is because of what Jesus has done. So we thank you for that today. God, I pray today that right now for all of us that we will all look into our hearts and we'll take advantage of the time, the moment that you have given us here is so brief and so quick that we take advantage of what you have given us here and now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
you please, during the playing of taps, remain silent. For those prior service or currently serving, please stand and render your salute. For all others, you may place your hand over your heart.
Thank you. salvation, we thank you for hope. God, we thank you for comfort. And God, just pray for Suzanne, Melissa, and Julie, Stephen, and Jonathan. God, I pray that you'll be the God of all comfort to them today, tomorrow, and the weeks to come, the months to come, the years to come. God, that you'll fill their hearts with joy, the joy unspeakable. And you'll fill their hearts with hope. God, we thank you that today is not the end. It's just the changing of the chapter, God. So we thank you for family and friends that come here today. We ask for hedge protection over everyone today as they drive home, that you would help everyone get home safely today, oh God. So we thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.